First, we present the story of a 7-year-old boy who was torn from his family and sent into slavery in the Sudan. On the morning of May 15th, 1986, Francis Bach was living in a tiny village in the southern Sudan. Sent to the marketplace by his mother to sell peanuts and eggs, Francis was unaware that he would never see his family again. His village became the target of an attacking band of slave traders who massacred hundreds of Sudanese, including Francis's parents, and turned the village children into slave captives. He was taken 200 miles from his home and forced to tend cattle in a field. He was property now, owned by one of the slave traders. His welcome was a beating with sticks by the trader's family and a warning that he would be shot if he tried to escape. Treated like an animal and beaten almost daily, he remained captive for 10 years. Determined that there must be a life beyond that of a slave, Francis eventually escaped to the Sudanese capital of Khartoum, and later Cairo, and finally to the United States, where he settled in North Dakota.
And I want you to do whatever you can.
Today, he speaks on the subject of slavery throughout the United States.
I had never, ever witnessed that person before, and I've seen a lot of people who've been killed. You know, I seen blood running like water on the river, a small river. And this is something that a little kid don't want to see. 7 years old like I, and even youngest kid were in that market. I really thank God, you know, and being able to get away from that situation when nothing happened to me. I was worried. I thought maybe they're going to kill me. You know, they're going to shoot me like they shot some kid running because they didn't mean to shoot them. They don't actually kill the kid. They take them with them. There's somewhere they kill kids with the parents when they put them in a big hut and burn it with the family. But most of the time when they capture the kids, they take all of them with the women to slavery.
So what happened when you first arrived at your master's house?
I was given to a guy named Juma Abdullah who took me after we divided up to militiamen. And this man took me to his farm. And I remember when I first arrived on his farm, he called the whole family to meet me. Include the neighbors, I can see them watching. And he sent his 3 children to beat me. And all of them were having sticks, and they started beating me. And they were shouting, you know, calling me Abid, Abid. And Abid means in Arabic, black slave.
But there you were, taken out of your life, and now you were something less than human, would it be safe to say?
Yes, I was less than human because they treat animals better than I.
Your final day with him after you, was it the day of escape for the last time?
The last time when I made it away from him,
yeah,
I escaped. He didn't release me. And I don't think he was going to release me. He wasn't going to tell me, go back home now to your parents, or maybe, you did a good job for me for all this year.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I give you this and leave. No, he wasn't going to do that. I believe so. He was going to keep me until the time, you know, get sick of me and want to replace me with a new, you know, slave. He was going to kill me or maybe sell me to somebody else. That's what can happen. But I'm glad I made it away before that happened. You know, I said I'd rather die than be a slave.
So there was a day when you awakened and said, enough, this is the day I go.
Yes. It's a day that I've been dreaming of since the first day that they brought me to this farm. And then 10 years later, I'm still having the same dream that I want to get away from them. Maybe something bad wouldn't have happened that time because I wasn't going to give up. I was going to fight back. I was going to resist with that person. So when I made that decision at the end, the third attempt, nobody saw me at all. I ran away the same time in the morning, 4 in the morning, leaving the cows in a nearby forest and been running all day long on the big forest. And I went to Khartoum, the capital. And I went to refugee camps called Jabrona, where I spent almost 2 years in that refugee camps, where there's a lot of South Sudanese people who left their villages since the war began in 1986. And a lot of people been killed and people all separated. They don't know, you know, rest of their family. And And I was actually going around a lot of camps, you know, to really seek for my family, and I couldn't find them. I actually meet people that know them by names, you know them, even their parents, you know, and they tell me that, you know, since the war began, a lot of people been killed, a lot of family been burned in the huts, you know, a lot of family been killed, shot, you know, men or women, and maybe they are alive and they are somewhere else. We don't know where.
Can you remember a moment when it just hit you, bang, I'm a free man?
Yes, I do. I do when I first actually welcoming by one of the co-worker for the Luden Social Service when I first arrived in the United States. Mm-hmm. And he took me to the apartment that the Luden people rented for me, who sponsored me, and he gave me a tour in the apartment and he left. And I said to myself, with the really big, deep breath, you know, and I said, wow, I am free now.